There's a lot of pressure here on both sides, but of course, once again, let's recap Wolfglick's accomplishments. The winningest player really in VGC history, of course, 2016 World Champion, Players Cup Champion in 2020, 7 times Regional Champion. He won 2 US National Championships in 2011 and 2012, and then was the North American International Championship, so even larger than Nationals in 2019. And this is, I believe, his 11th Regional Finals, if I'm correct. He's played in 10 so far until now, lost 3 of them and won 7.
Which is so impressive in
70%
itself.
70% win rate in Regionals Finals. That's pretty darn good.
Yeah, I think the odds might be in his favor when it comes down to that statistic. But he's put so much faith into this team of 6. He stated before this tournament he wanted to be able to play with a team that was just all great Pokemon. And what great choices he made. Urshifu Rapid Strike has been a dominant force in the metagame because of its ability Unseen Fist being able to bypass Protect. But he's also rounded out this team with some just big favorites that have topped the usage charts.
There's been a lot of emphasis from Wolf's team on Pokemon like Frigraph as well as Incineroar and Urshifu. We've talked a lot about Fluttermane throughout the course of this tournament. It's on Wolf's team, but I don't think we've actually really seen him bring it out on stream. And so when we've seen these players go up against each other previously, a lot of emphasis early on leads like Frigraph, Urshifu, as well as Frigraph and Ogerpon.
While we see a lot of good stuff on Wolf's team, Nicholas is going to be bringing the heat when it comes down to this more unorthodox mixture of Pokemon that he's got on here, especially when it comes down to the 2 different forms of speed control. You've got the Tornadus to go for a fast mode with a Tailwind, and the Ferrigarath to go for a Trick Room to really help set up something like that Blood Moon or Saluna. But the other key piece of this puzzle might be a familiar favorite, the Iron Hands, really unique in this regulation rule set in particular.
Yeah, this Iron Hands has Clear Amulet and Close Combat, and we saw Nicholas pair it with Ferrigarath to put on huge amounts of offensive pressure. With that combination, you can go for Helping Hand Close Combat and just burst things down very, very quickly. To me, I think a lot about these early games will be about the leads. Last time these trainers went up against each other, Nicholas actually switched up his leads in all 3 games, whereas Wolf was very heavy on prioritizing Ferrigarath as well as either Ogerpon or Urshifu next to it. So we saw when these players fought against each other previously that the Blood Moon Ursaluna put on a lot of offensive pressure. So I'm wondering if the Nicholas wants to kind of adjust and go back to Blood Moon, because Blood Moon just does so much damage to Wolf's entire team.
It really does. And I think that as long as you can get that Trick Room set up, you're in such a good position. But that Ferrigarath is so pesky coming through from Wolf's side when you have the possibility of reversing that Trick Room right away. But let's get into it. The grand finals of the Charlotte Regional Championships between Nicholas Donnelly and Wolfglick. And Nick's going to be leading the charge with that Blood Moon Ursaluna and the Ogerpon. And for Wolf, it's the Ogerpon as well, but next to that Ferrigarath.
So this is already really explosive because Ursaluna has so much offensive pressure onto both sides. Now, Nicholas also has the Follow Me on his Ogerpon, and so with that, you're able to redirect any powerful attacks off onto that Ursaluna slot. So Ogerpon here could go for a Follow Me. There's a lot of pressure from Wolf's, and I think one thing that Wolf does really well is pressure Trick Room at any given point, but it's going to be Ferrigarath switching out this time around. By going for this, you cover for something like the Fire Terra Ogerpon Ivy Cudgel into that slot, which otherwise would potentially just knock out the Ferrigarath.
Especially because his Ferrigarath is Throat Spray. It does not have the Citrus Berry healing that we have come to expect from a lot of the Ferrigarath in this meta, but it's going to be a Terastallization right away, and on Nicholas's side it will be that Blood Moon Ursaluna that gets that Terra Charge. That Terra Normal is going to really help to boost up these Hyper Voices.
Yeah, I mean, Terra Normal Hyper Voice is a ridiculous combination, so Spiky Shield comes out. Let's see what Nicholas opted for. Did he just go for a Hyper Voice? Because that would be a lot of damage to start off the game. Ogerpon goes for Follow Me. The idea of that is to cover for opposing Ogerpon going for a Terra Ivy Cudgel, for example. And it is that Hyper Voice. And so that's a lot of key damage without losing too many resources from Nicholas's end. This is going to do a lot of damage to Incineroar.
It really is. I mean, Incineroar is going to take 50% from that Terra Hyper Voice. And while you do see that Life Orb really helping that damage output, you still have to find a way to keep this Ursaluna in check.
Yeah, so there is the possibility of just Swords Dance and Fake Out now, which is relatively free. Ferrigarath as a switch in here. Oh, this is a risky play, of course, because Nicholas could play really aggressively and just target down Ogerpon, right? You are vulnerable to something like the Blood Moon coming out and just getting a one-hit knockout onto Ogerpon, and Wolf's not going to click the Fake Out here. So Ogerpon's going to switch out. Is Blood Moon going to protect itself here?
What's going to be a Ferrigarath taking the place of that Hearthflame Ogre Pawn on Nick's side, as Incineroar is also going to make that quick pivot. And we did see Wolf want to bring that Frigoraph back out in its place. But yeah, is it a protect here? It's just going to be a Sword Stance from the Ogre Pawn, so no protect coming through from Nick's Blood Moon.
Is he going for Blood Moon? Okay, it's just another Hyper Voice, but this is massive amounts of damage. Let's see how much it does into the Ogre Pawn. Almost just gets the one-hit knockout, but does not actually secure it, so it's a big survival there for Wolf.
It's a huge survival, but this Ogre Pawn here, while it does have this Sword Stance, it still has to figure out where is it going to be able to connect this damage. Ursa Luna on Nick's side could go for something like the Protect, but the Frigoraph as well can't do that.
You could go for Protect and Trick Room, but the risk in that, of course, is that then the Ogre Pawn could theoretically go for Ivy Cudgel onto the opposing Frigoraph. So I think Nicholas has been playing super well so far, though, getting so much free damage across the board. It was a crucial survival there on Ogre Pawn. I think if Blood Moon had come out instead and gotten that one-hit knockout, Wolf would be in a disastrous position, but at least has some offensive pressure right now with the Ogre Pawn. So let's see. This turn is really critical from Nicholas's end. There's not going to be the Protect here. So there's Ivy Cudgel, and that's a one-hit knockout onto Ursa Luna.
Ursa Luna not necessarily known for its bulk, and especially when you've got that plus two Sword Stance, that Ivy Cudgel is going to hurt. But now Nick has the opportunity to hopefully do something else with his Frigoraph to set up for success in the late game. He's gonna take that Hyper Voice really nicely, but Wolf now gets that special attack boost thanks to Throat Spray.
All right, let's see if it's a Trick Room going up. It is going to be Trick Room, so yeah, I think if Blood Moon just protected there, this game actually would feel pretty over, but of course the risk you have to take there is you don't know where the Ogre Pawn is targeting, and so Wolf making the correct decision saying, I think your Blood Moon's not going to protect, I'm just going to attack into you. Urshifu comes out. It's kind of an awkward Pokemon, though, admittedly, to bring out when Trick Room is up.
Yeah, because usually Ogre Pawn in this position would be faster than the Urshifu, so you feel like you're just gonna be taking a ton of damage, and the Frigoraph is also going to be faster in Trick Room condition, so Urshifu also just has to take the hit.
Exactly. Frigoraph right now puts on a lot of offensive pressure with this Hyper Voice, and so let's see. Right now, I think Frigoraph on Wolf's end should be able to get a guaranteed Hyper Voice. Nicholas has Imprisoned, but he does not have Hyper Voice on his side of the field. Incineroar is going to be a nice switch in here to allow Ogre Pawn to protect itself for a little bit, and Frigoraph should be able to do a lot of damage from Wolf's end right now.
Yeah, Urshifu does have the Focus Sash on Nick's side to be able to keep it safe, so at the very least, you know that you will be able to get an attack off. While Frigoraph gets the Citrus Berry healing, it still took a considerable amount of damage. Dazzling Gleam in response just barely does any chip to both Pokemon, and with the Wicked Blow into Wolf's Frigoraph, while it does get the KO, you're still in a very precarious position.
Wow, this is such an intense game right now. I think both players making some really good calls throughout the course of the battle. Of course, Incineroar on Wolf's end critically can't go for that Fake Out because of Frigoraph on Nicholas's end. It's really awkward to have this Urshifu in the back as well because, of course, it is Choice Scarfed. But the upside of the Urshifu is that you're not actually threatened by knockouts from the opposing side. So normally it feels a little bit weird to bring a Choice Scarf Urshifu in under Trick Room, but I think it actually makes a lot of sense in this position. What Wolf has to be really careful about is having Urshifu out on the field when Nicholas has his Ogre Pawn, because without Protect, if Trick Room is up, all it takes is one single Grass-type attack to basically nuke it. So Urshifu is going to make this pivot in right now.
The Urshifu can't protect, so that is something else that does make this matchup a little bit risky, but oh, I saw the Aqua Jet for a brief second there, and I considered, would that be the play, just to be able to make sure that you're getting some damage down in Trick Room?
Yeah, it'd be really bold. I think if you're Aqua Jetting, you're basically reading that Frigoraph is going to switch
right out.
Which is, but you know, we've seen Wolf make really crazy predictions, but I think this is a great position, actually, for Water Terra Surging Strikes if you're confident Flare Blitz is going to get the knockout onto the Urshifu slot, right? Frigoraph can't protect itself, and so I think the Incineroar right now might just be able to do enough to secure this end game here. So I think, like, you could either go for U-turn or the Surging Strikes. What U-turn covers for is Frigoraph switching out into the Ogre Pawn slot, but no switch.
No switch here. We see the Terrestrialization come through. It's also really nice knowing that Nicholas could go for something like the Dazzling Gleam, so you also get rid of that weakness with that fighting type. So Urshifu here able to power itself up if it does come back in and get those Surging Strikes down, but Flare Blitz is enough to be able to knock out Nicholas's Urshifu. So another big source of damage off the board. You just have that Hearthflame Ogre Pawn that's in the back.
Yeah, and the Surging Strikes here certainly will, I would guess, knock out the Urshifu. Gets the critical hit there, but not enough to get the knockout. Actually, it is U-turn, and oh, Frigoraph does survive here, okay?
Okay, Frigoraph gets to live to see another turn, but we did see that Incineroar is faster right now. So is it going to be enough to be able to outplay both the Ogre Pond and the Incineroar.
Yeah, I think Surging Strikes there likely would have just ended the game, but trying to bait out maybe the Ogre Pond, switch in there and get some positioning as well. So Ogre Pond from Nicholas's end is, of course, at full health. One of the things you have to be worried about is just a Horn Leech, right? And so now Wolf opting to just go for damage here onto both sides. The Frigrap on Nicholas's end does not have Protect, so it will just get knocked out by Incineroar right now.
So then can Ogre Pond finish the job?
Oh,
he's gonna just go for the
follow me.
Yeah, now you are gonna redirect away the knockoff because, and that's actually not gonna do nearly as much damage because you can't knock off the item that Ogre Pond is holding.
Ogre Pond hangs on, Incineroar does faint.
That Ogre Pond surviving there. Nick is not happy about that. It's the Ivy Cudgel now coming down into the Ogre Pond, but it's not gonna go down either.
Oh my gosh, this game is so dramatic, but I think Urshifu should be able to close it out at this point. The main threat to Urshifu in this game was first the Blood Moon and then the Ogre Pond, but you've done enough damage to Ogre Pond at this point, so should be able to guarantee the knockout onto that slot. I mean, Trick Room is actually still up, though. Actually,
wait, so... Horn Leech?
Hold on. Yeah.
I think you might just go for Horn
Leech
in this position.
Horn Leech, yeah.
That might be enough. You can't go for Aqua Jet because the Frigrap is still on the field, blocking the priority with the Armor Tail, but we are going to see the spiky shield first, as Nick is going to have to try to work his way out of this one. The Dazzling Gleam first to connect onto the Urshifu to just do a little bit of damage. But what did this Ogre Pond decide to do?
There's the... Oh, it went for Ivy Cudgel!
Ivy Cudgel onto the Urshifu is just not going to be nearly enough, and so Urshifu strikes back. One hit will do the job to finish off that Ogre Pond, and that's going to be lights out here for game number one.
So the reason it was Ivy Cudgel is because Nick actually has Wood Hammer on the Ogre Pond. So if you go for Wood Hammer, you faint from recoil, and then Wolf ends up winning in the Ogre Pond versus Frigaraf matchup. And so that was, this game is so crazy.
Oh my goodness. I actually forgot that it was not the Horn Leech there, but with the final Surging Strikes, that is the conclusion of game number one of our best of three set in the grand finals of Charlotte. And Wolf is gonna take this game one.
I'm reminding myself to take a deep breath because there's so much going on that even as a commentator, I'm like, oh my goodness, like what is happening right now? That was an amazing first match. I feel like both players played super, super well. Nicholas had some really nice early game pressure, but a couple key decisions allowed Wolf to get back into this game in the mid game, right? Was able to go for that Sword Stance. The Blood Moon did not come out from Ursaluna, so did not get a one-hit knockout onto the opposing Ogre Pond. And after that, getting that Sword Stance boost, he was able to just knock out the Blood Moon in one hit, right? The key decision to target Blood Moon there rather than targeting Frigaraf. I think if that turn goes wrong for Wolf, he probably just loses the game on the spot, right? Because if Trick Room gets set up and Blood Moon is under Trick Room, Blood Moon, I think, just starts sweeping you. So Blood Moon is a really, really good Pokemon, and I think Nicholas managed it really well in the early game, and Wolf had to make some bold predictions to get back into it, but it paid off. And, oh man, the decision of Wood Hammer here instead of Horn Leech actually really punishes Nicholas as well. If that were a Horn Leech, I think Nicholas just takes that game, but he did have enough turns of Trick Room to work with, just not enough HP. Ogre Pond surviving with just a sliver of HP.
I can't believe it.
If Ogre Pond faints at that end game, that Wood Hammer secures you the victory as well.
It does. It's so difficult when you're building these teams because you have to outweigh all of the different possibilities of why you would want one move over another. In this position, you might have wanted the Horn Leech, but in others, that Wood Hammer does so much damage. The recoil, though, is going to be a secondary effect that makes it a little bit harder to weave in that end game. But now we have to think about the adjustments for this game number two. And I feel like Wolf just has been so comfortable with this Frigaraf.
Blood Moon feels so good here from Nicholas, right? He was able to get a huge lead in that first game by playing exceptionally with it. And so I think if you're Nicholas, you might be happy still going back to Ogre Pond and the Blood Moon and just saying, you know what, I'm just going to be a little bit better in terms of when to click the Blood Moon specifically to try to just knock out Ogre Pond. And so let's see if both players run it back because, yeah, both players definitely had the tools to win that one. These battles are just so close, and it is going to be a run back here with Ogre Pond and Ursaluna.
Right, Ogre Pond, Ursaluna versus the Frigaraf and Ogre Pond. It's a run back of the same leads for both trainers in our game number one. So where does this turn go different?
Oh, you can already see Wolf's thinking about the aggression here. This is actually how he beat Nicholas in the third game when they played each other previously in this tournament. So looking to play really, really aggressively here. Oh my goodness. Okay, so we're going full in on offense right now this turn for Wolf. He is looking to just get rid of the redirection user immediately to start this game.
If he's able to get the KO here, then this could be a very, very fast game. With the Terrastalization onto the Hearthflame Ogre Pawn, you get the Embody Aspect boost, +1 to your attack. This is going to be a lot of damage. And we're also going to see another Terrastalization on the other side. Nicholas, this time around, will commit that Terra to the Ursaluna once again.
Okay, so we know where the targeting is going right now, so I think the safe play for Nicholas is to just opt for Follow Me, but you could make a crazy play of Spiky Shield. It is just going to be that Follow Me, though, so it is going to eat up so much damage from this Ivy Cudgel.
I wonder if this could be a knockout with a crit, honestly.
Even without a crit, I think it might get the KO, but let's see.
Ivy Cudgel comes down. Ogre Pawn is not going to be able to take it. That is a one-hit knockout. And now with that redirection, yes, this Ursaluna can go for some big damage with the Terra Normal Hyper Voice, but that's a key piece. You might have wanted to have that redirection for later.
Okay, this gets really interesting if Nicholas made an adjustment of Tornadus in
what?
The back. Oh, but the critical hit means Ursaluna will only get one more attack off there. The worst time to see a crit if you're Nicholas, because that means Ursaluna just does not have that much firepower left, and Wolf is off to a huge start in this game. There's no Tornadus in the back either, so right now Nicholas has the speed advantage.
Yeah, wow, this is an absolute showstarter for this very first turn. This Ursaluna, yeah, it's gotta get as much done as it can right now. But do you read into it too much if you're Nicholas and expect to see a bit more of a passive play from Wolf? It's just gonna be a protect here, hoping that this Urshifu is gonna be able to do anything this turn.
Okay, the Ivy Cudgel does go into that slot, so Wolf had the opportunity to just secure the knockout onto Urshifu this turn. This buys Nicholas some time, and this is actually a pretty big deal because you get the knockout onto Lefrigraph. Now, that means that Ferrigraph's ability is no longer in effect. So, Urshifu from Nicholas's end can now go for Sucker Punch. Of course, there is this Incineroar and the Urshifu in the back, so Scarf Urshifu, a really, really nice switch in to put on so much offensive pressure right now.
Yeah, you get to go for the Ivy Cudgel here again. You can also pivot out the Urshifu. We saw that that fourth and final in the back will help, especially if there's another physical attacker from Nick for his fourth and final. But this Ursaluna, it just protected, so it's really unsafe right now. Nick does not want to let this Ursaluna go down without a fight, so it's gonna be the Ferrigraph that takes its place.
So the U-turn lock here means that it will be able to switch out, and the Sucker Punch does secure the knockout here onto the Ogre Pawn as well. So despite a rough critical hit start from Nicholas, he will be able to secure two knockouts.
Now Wolf is down to his final two, and the pivot potential has now come off the field. The Ferrigraph takes the U-turn really well here too. Not gonna put it into that Citrus Berry range, but that means that it still has that HP recovery for later. Incineroar, the fourth one for Wolf in this second game.
Incineroar comes back out. The Terras have been committed. Oh my goodness, this is just so close right now. You're able to, you know, get that U-turn for some nice chip damage onto Ferrigraph, but the Ferrigraph does have Citrus Berry. So Wolf is now down to the point where you have to commit and lock into a move with the Urshifu. You've gotten the Intimidate off onto the opposing Urshifu, which is really valuable. One of the interesting things that I don't expect to see, but you could do, is actually side knockoff if you wanted to get rid of your Choice Scarf and be able to, you know, click other moves throughout the course of this battle. But let's see, there is that Blood Moon in the back, right? So it might be able to get one more big attack up, but it's just gonna be Helping Hand here onto the Urshifu.
So big Helping Hand means that this Ferrigraph is gonna take the Surging Strikes, but it doesn't look like it's gonna be nearly enough. As the Citrus Berry activates, it's gonna heal back out of the range of getting knocked out to the last two strikes from this Urshifu. So what is this Urshifu on Nick's side gonna go
it's
for?
It's gotta be a close combat,
has
right? You would think
be.
Close combat, you try to get the knockout onto Incineroar, so let's see. There's close combat onto Incineroar. Does it get the one-hit knockout? It does! And Nicholas has knocked out three of Wolf's Pokemon. It's just down to this Choice Scarf Urshifu, but can it be able to pull off this victory?
It's stuck now using Surging Strikes, and we saw just how well that this Ferrigraph can take it. So Urshifu, with this defense drop, is that gonna put it in range of getting knocked out?
Okay, there's no switch from either end, so Ferrigraph just clicks Trick Room or Dazzling Gleam here. I think Nicholas is actually gonna take us to a game three.
He's smiling.
Oh, and Urshifu
survives anyway, so it doesn't even matter. The Urshifu goes for the close combat just to be able to chip away, but this Ferrigraph gets a chance to help it out with the Trick Room. And with that Ursaluna in the back, feels over.
We are going to a game three, ladies and gentlemen. This is such an exciting set to be able to watch and commentate. These players have played 8 games against each other already. We're gonna go down to game number 9 to see who claims the title of the biggest regional champion of all time.
No way.
I thought it was done for. That critical hit came out and I was like, how is Nicholas gonna pull this off? But Nicholas made the right play protecting Ferrigraph, made the right play going for Sucker Punch on an Ogre Pond, and set up Trick Room at the perfect time. And so I cannot believe this set. This is incredible.
The absolute courage that Nick has had to have to make some of these plays as well. It's amazing. It is amazing. I am lost for words at how back and forth all of these games have been between both of these players. Let's relive some of the moments from this second game. I mean, the Ogre Pond, right away it got knocked out after that follow me direction, which left this Ursaluna so vulnerable, especially after it got crit by that Hyper Voice.
Oh my goodness. So I'm curious if we just see a run back with the same leads. One of the things I was thinking about is if you were Nicholas bringing that Tornadus in the back to actually enable a Tailwind mode, but I can see why it feels really risky to do that, right? And so, like, just the leads themselves, like, are really volatile on turn 1. There's so many plays that both players can make. And so this is the game time decision making, right? Like, what do you lead when you've played against each other 8 different times? You've tried out different leads. What are you going to bet on for this final game to claim the championship?
Do you roll the dice? do you roll your lucky dice? And
you just
say,
you know what? Let's just try something new.
Let's rock it.
Oh,
it might take that, though. It might take having to shut off that part of your brain that goes, but we've played this 8 times already. Every single time the lead has been different. Every single time the turn 1 has been different. How do I catch him off guard? Shut it off. Tunnel vision. Just go full send.
The turn 1 is just so, so scary, right? Because there's so much that can happen. And I think that this Blood Moon, once again, one of the reasons why it was surging going into this tournament is because of how much damage it does. And Wolf's team generally wants to play a really bulky and bulky-oriented game. But Blood Moon just puts on immense offensive pressure immediately. So both players have locked in. And folks, we are going to game 3 in this grand finals.
Who is going to win the biggest regional championship of the season? It's Wolf Glick versus Nicholas Donnelly. Wolf, the most decorated player in VGC, versus Nick, who has been on a tear this entire competition. It all comes down to this final game between these two players, where Nick is going to be bringing the Blood Moon Ursaluna and the Ogre Pond once again, but Wolf switching it up.
So the idea here behind Wolf's lead is now you pressure with Fake Out into Swords Dance immediately. This means that you can deny Ursaluna immediately, but also, okay, just considering, going really, really aggressive here, Parting Shot, and considering Ivy Cudgel as well, but that could be really risky if the Ogre Pond decides to just go for a Terra and go for a Follow Me. This is gonna be an explosive turn 1. Yeah, Wolf locking in what I would say is a pretty unconventional play here.
Worked out last time to be able to get the knockout onto the Hearthflame Ogre Pond on Nick's side once it went for that Follow Me. But will it work a second time? Or does Nick decide to change it up and make this turn 1 look very different?
Basically, Nick is worried about Fake Out and Swords Dance. So the prediction is, do you just expect him to make the obvious Fake Out Swords Dance play? Or do you go on the aggressive?
Looks like we see a little bit of a head shake there from Nick. Is he expecting this to come through, as the Terra from the Hearthflame Ogre Pond feels like such a run back from what we saw in that game number 2.
Oh my goodness, I am holding my breath as we see how this first turn plays out. All right, it's gonna be a trade of the Terras here to start.
Is it gonna be the Ursaluna once again though?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so do we get a chance to see this Ursaluna get off another big Terra Normal Hyper Voice? What does this Ogre Pond decide to do on Nick's side? It goes for the Follow Me. So it is going to redirect away the attention from this Ursaluna. This time around, the Ivy Cudgel hitting into it again. It got the knockout last time. It should be another knockout here.
We are off to the races, folks. Ogre Pond gets 1-hit KO'd by its opposing Ogre Pond here. And now Ursaluna goes for the Blood Moon this time. Does not opt for the Hyper Voice. And that's going to be able to take care of Wolf Terra immediately to start off this game.
What a huge piece for Wolf to have off the board immediately, Terrestrialization now no longer able to be committed in a defensive manner. And with this Blood Mourner, Soluna, yes, okay, you're gonna get Parting Shot here, but you still have the Life Orb to help mitigate any of that special attack drop.
That's an amazing trade for Nicholas, in my opinion. I feel like in this trade-off, every time we've seen Ogre Pawn survive, because it just hangs on with a sliver from Hyper Voice, but this time, it faints. And so Wolf, at least, has been able to mitigate the damage of the Ursaluna Blood Moon, thanks to that Parting Shot, now able to bring out Urshifu for close combat pressure. But Nicholas now gets a free switch in as well. You could, of course, pivot in your Ferrigarath.
You could. And in that situation, too, I think the Urshifu makes a nice call here, because that Ursaluna can't just sit there and go for a Protect. So you have to figure out, what can you do in this situation to help keep this Blood Moon safe? What is in the back here for Nick to potentially make a switch into that slot?
Oh, this turn is so intense, because like the obvious play would be to close combat Ursaluna, right? So yeah, we see close combat knockoff, but Nicholas could switch out the Ursaluna. This is very similar to the position we had previously. Does he decide to switch, or does the Blood Moon just get knocked out here? This turn is so, so crucial.
We're a couple of moments away of determining whether or not this also just might be the end of the game. A huge swing here could turn the tides immediately.
Blood Moon doesn't switch out.
There's
close
no
combat
switch.
Into the Ursaluna.
It's
That's
just
a one-hit knockout.
No way. Ursaluna doesn't get a chance to move. And if it was a Trick Room coming out from the Ferrigarath, does Nick have anything in the back that can actually take advantage of that?
Oh my goodness, the knockoff's gonna remove the Citrus Berry as well. It deals so much damage to Ferrigarath. If Blood Moon had switched out there and Trick Room goes up, I think Nicholas probably wins this finals. But now he is down his strongest attacker. Trick Room gets set up there. Nicholas, of course, once again predicting, I don't think you're gonna target Blood Moon. The Trick Room setup is too obvious, but Wolf gets the call correct twice in this grand finals.
This has been a trade of calls and predictions. And right now, it's going to be Wolf that's in the driver's seat for this grand finals. Is an Urshifu in the back here for Nick. And we have seen him make a comeback with the Urshifu versus Urshifu in this matchup.
All right, so there are the defense drops on the opposing Urshifu. So obviously, Dazzling Gleam is pretty scary. Nicholas's close combat is also pretty scary right now, but there is still a lot of offensive pressure. This Incineroar is looking quite good. Wolf's Scarf Urshifu locked into kind of a weird place under Trick Room right now, but let's see. I think Ferrigarath might be able to take one more knockoff, which would be really, really pivotal. I think if you faint a knockoff, you might just lose the game immediately.
Yeah, good to call out there that now that the Citrus Berry is removed, that knockoff would deal less damage to the Ferrigarath. Ferrigarath is going to go for the Helping Hand, though, really hoping
Does
that
it
will survive.
Against the knockout!
It just doesn't survive that. After the Helping Hand, it's going to go down, but hopefully with one last hurrah for Urshifu, its partner, the close combat will get the knockout onto Wolf's Urshifu, but Wolf still has one more Pokemon in the back. It's a 2v1.
And Trick Room has been set up this time around, but it does not help Nicholas. You're staring down Ferrigarath and Incineroar. The key Pokemon on Wolf's team. Wolf can just go for Hyper Voice and Flare Blitz now. Urshifu's got to kind of stall in its own Trick Room, which makes this really, really awkward.
It
but
really
with three
does.
Turns, I think Nicholas is going to need a triple Protect right now.
The triple Protect is possible. The odds are very, very unlikely, but you could still do it, or you try to make another really, really big call. But as we saw Wolf lock into two attacks, it's gonna come down to the wire. The Urshifu does get the first one, of course, but what happens in these next few turns?
I think Nicholas has to go for the triple, then you go for knockoff, or sorry, the Wicked Blow into Ferrigarath, and then close combat into Incineroar. But the odds are extremely stacked against Nicholas. If he fails one of these next two protects, Wolf will become an 8-time regional champion. It all comes down to this.
All
two
comes
more
down
turns.
To this.
I haven't seen a triple protect on stream in so, so, so long. Urshifu goes for the protect. It fails.
It's not going to be able to save itself from this one. The Flare Blitz from the Incineroar is going to deal so much damage to the Urshifu to put it on one last life as the Ferrigarath hopes to follow it up and get the KO with the Hyper Voice. And with that attack, Wolf Glick becomes your Charlotte Regional Champion, 8-time winner.
The
no
King
way.
Is back, ladies and gentlemen. He took 3 months off this game and came back and shows it's just as easy as riding a bike, only dropping one set throughout the entire tournament. He was the victor of the previous largest tournament of all time, and now he is the winner of the newly largest tournament of all time.
What a momentum that Wolf is on. Nick put up such a valiant effort in this grand finals. Third time could have been the charm. but you gotta get the third time on the protect, and it just wasn't able to come through. Wolf with some really critical reads in those games to be able to take it down.